our keynote speaker, Arun Gupta, who, as I said before, was the editor and or publisher of the Guardian, the U.S. National Newsweekly, Occupied Wall Street Journal, and The Independent, and he's now a freelance grassroots journalist.
Yes.
And some of us have known Arun for years. Yes, and very, very happy to see you, Arun.
Thanks for having me.
You'll be talking on community media in the age of Trump.
Yeah. Thank you. So, you know, I'm sure, hopefully everyone's gotten over their shock, right? You know, it was the whole experience was traumatic. And it's not like we were going to be excited about Hillary Clinton or by any means, but no one expected Trump to win. And as we've seen it, I think in the last week, and I've been saying for a year, take this guy seriously. He's going about fulfilling his agenda, which is a very extreme agenda. It's different from what we've seen before. It's a proto-fascistic agenda. It joins the most extreme wings of capital to military, direct military control of policing, civilian policing functions, right? It's, you know, if Marx said that the state was the executive committee of the bourgeoisie, they no longer need the executive committee, right? It's ruled by billionaires and generals. They've pretty much taken out the middlemen. And as a mobilizing force, it's tied also to just as also one of the most extreme versions of Christian nationalism, dominionism, as represented by Mike Pence. Now, what is going on, you know, what we've seen in terms of all these executive orders, what we're hearing about 500,000 people are basically U.S. residents are now going to be barred from coming back into the country. They're cranking up the machinery of mass deportations, and I argue that we need to see this in the context of ethnic cleansing. This is an extraordinarily dangerous moment. But in dangerous moments, that there is also opportunity. So let's not, you know, lose sight of it either way. That there's simply a lot of bad things that are going to happen, and that there's not a lot we can do in the short term. You know, of course, bad things would have happened under Clinton as well. But, you know, my argument is that these are two different forces. So, but I think there are really opportunities in that we see that the liberals have been very much discredited. The liberal ideology, the neoliberal ideology, what Bill Clinton bought in 1992, third wayism, this idea that there's a third way between socialism and capitalism. He's the one who really bought it in first the Western world. Tony Blair followed him, then the other European governments. But we saw this very much spread through the global South as well, you know, in terms of Brazil, the major states in the global South, Brazil, South Africa, in India and elsewhere, that you could somehow unfetter capital, allow it to search the globe for profits, but you could still offer some protection for workers. That was always a lie, but, you know, what we have really seen is this lie has been exposed. So the question is, you know, now where do we go forward, right? You know, it's just because something is discredited does not mean it's over, or does not mean that the left is suddenly magically going to take power. With the 2008 crisis, neoliberalism was very much discredited, and, you know, Barack Obama was essentially, he was backed by the ruling class, media, Wall Street, and corporate America to try and salvage the neoliberal project, and he very much did that in a lot of ways. You know, a lot of people got, I think, infatuated, you know, with the image of an African American family in the White House, as well as, you know, it was a breath of fresh air where you don't have a president or their family is mired in scandal. But nonetheless, we saw this extraordinary concentration of wealth and power, this expansion of the security state, wiretapping, all these different wars. And so 2016, you had essentially two ways that it splits, two different reactions, populist reactions against neoliberalism. One was consolidated by Bernie Sanders that, of course, you know, did not work out, and the other was by Donald Trump. So now I think we have a different system, this kind of like authoritarian proto-fascistic capitalism. You know, I think essentially we're on the road to fascism. You know, we're in the car, we're driving down to road. Where it heads, we have no idea. You know, and whether that car is going 10, 20, 30 miles an hour right now, we have no idea either, but we are clearly on this road. So I think the role for the left is to, Trump was traumatic, and, you know, I think it's even more of a break than in many ways September 11th. You know, September 11th changed everything. I think one of the interesting phenomena of aspects of Trump's victory is it actually changes, it doesn't change what's going forward, it changes what came past, it actually changes history. That we need to address, you know, where has the left gone wrong? You know, I think the left narrative, the left critique is largely the correct one. But we don't have mass forces in this country. Let's be clear about this. You know, we should be having like, you know, 5,000 people here talking about this. So I think the key is really to get back to base building. And this is where, you know, community media plays an extremely important role. One thing that I've been doing over the last year, I report on all sorts of different issues. They're all kind of interrelated. What I'm trying to do is understand essentially how social movements come into being and reproduce themselves. So I report on the left, I report on immigrants' rights movements, on all sorts of labor struggles, Black Lives Matter, environmental justice movement, but I also report on the right wing a lot. I report on militias. I was out at the Bundy occupation in Eastern Oregon exactly 1 year ago. I also covered the Trump campaign. And most recently, I was out in Indiana talking to factory workers at three different factories, two plants owned by Carrier. This is the plant where Trump said he was going to save all their jobs. And then there's a third factory, Rexnord. This plant Trump also went after. All three of these companies are sending jobs down to Mexico. And so I was talking to these workers. It's mixed race, mixed gender. Some of the factories, it's actually a majority of women who work in these factories. And so Trump, you know, if you remember at the beginning of December, he came in and said, you know, we're saving, you know, all these jobs at this Carrier factory. He made it a big issue. This was the plant where a year ago the company announced these mass layoffs. Someone took a video that went viral and Trump jumped on it. You know, Obama at one point said, these jobs ain't coming back. There's nothing you can do. Well, the fact of the matter is Trump did do something. And when I talked to these workers, that's what they kept saying. At least he did something. And I think this is really the role of that community media serves. This is a moment where the left needs to get out of its comfort zone, that it needs to go out and talk to people. You know, you're not necessarily going to disagree with them. Often you're going to find people you vehemently disagree with, or people who are frankly also our enemy. But what community media, I think the best part of the best roles it serves, it can serve many roles, but is to really get the voices of people who are struggling every day. It gives you a very different perspective. So I interviewed eight factory workers in Indiana who are losing their jobs, all of whom voted for Trump. Unionized factory workers. And we have to remember, in Indiana, Trump won it by nearly 20 points this time. In 2008, Obama won Indiana, a state that's 84% white, right? Suddenly, you know, nearly one-third of the white population did not magically become racist overnight, right? You know, time and again, these workers said to me who voted for Trump, NAFTA. NAFTA. They got it. They have, and liberals who deride these Trump voters, as which Paul Krugman does, that they don't know their self-interest. They have a very sharp sense of their own self-interest. They would name all these factories that used to be in Indiana. There used to be this Alcoa plant, this GM plant, Navistar, Pratt and Whitney making aircraft engines, Piles making speakers, on and on. And like, you know, long forgotten baseball stars, you know, and they're all gone. And they've seen what's been going on over the last 25 years, white, brown, and black, you know, that they still kind of have this path, you know, that for many of them, it's like, okay, you know, if I can continue to keep this factory job that pays $20 an hour, you know, maybe I can have a retirement, I can pay off my home, maybe my kids can go to college. But that path is getting more precarious ahead of them, and it's getting narrower and narrower behind them. You know, these are not the people. I also have, in the last few years, interviewed dozens of people in the Walmart and McDonald's economy. This is a much more desperate part of the economy, right? These are people I interview who, they tell me they survive on $25 a week for food per person. They go to fast food restaurants and steal napkins to use as toilet papers. They'll have shoes that fell apart a year ago, and they're still using them, held together with duct tape, because they can't, you know, they can't go to the doctor. They may have health care, but they're too afraid that if they take off time from work, they're going to get fired. That's not who these factories are, but the factory workers are very well aware that is what is below them. And they, you know, time and again, I talked to this one, the president of the steelworkers local. I interviewed him. I did all these 17 one-on-one interviews. Don Ziering, he was the president at Rexnord. And he's like, I didn't vote for Trump. I voted for the one who lost. And then he's like, but you know, Trump wasn't even president and he saved those jobs. You know, why couldn't Obama do that? And I only talked to one worker who admitted that they voted against their own self-interest. I met with Lakita Clark in her home in northern Indianapolis. She has four children. I met her right before she was going to Bible study. And she said, you know, I voted for Clinton. She's like, but I really liked Bernie Sanders. You know, I voted for him in the primary. I wanted him to win. And of course, this is, again, it's undercuts a various narrative. The Bernie bro, right? This African American church going woman was a big supporter of Bernie Sanders. And then she says, but I voted for Hillary Clinton. And and she works at Carrier, her job was safe. And she's like, if Hillary Clinton had won, I'd be out of a job now. Right, and so this I thought was really fascinating. These workers know exactly where their self-interest is, right? And this is why I think community media is incredibly important. No one is doing this stuff. No one is going into the communities and telling these stories. We have to tell these narratives, you know, and it's not about often whether you agree with them or not. We need to illuminate them, right? We are the media is saturated with opinion pieces, with analysis pieces, you know, with people doing hot takes. And, you know, I go to meetings and where I hear people, like, they talk about the working class as an object. You know, it's just like, no, the working class are subjects, right? Mm-hmm. I went to this event last night, three different socialist groups at Verso, packed. There was like 400 people in the room. They had an overflow room of 200. That was full. They had a Facebook live stream, over 300 on the live stream. And they're talking and these are mainly intellectuals and academics, but they talk of the working class as almost like this object and you know, that, you know, well, is there a working class? And it's just like, well, go actually talk to the working class, you know, and it doesn't matter whether they're white or black or brown, male or female, whatever their sexual orientation, they may have multiple identities, but they get their identities as workers, right? They are struggling, you know, they want to be assured that, you know, they can have a decent place to live, that they can have health care. So many of them are helping their children go to college. You know, Lakita Clark was my sons have big ambitions. One of them wants to be an architect, you know, and that is, you know, what she's working for, as well as, you know, she wants to one day be able to retire, you know, and she's like, I'm 40. I don't want this to happen to me again in 10 years. So she's now planning to go into nursing or healthcare. But it's through getting these voices, through being engaged in the community, right? So community media, we need to go out and tell these stories of people, of their daily lives as it exists. And that is, I think, really how we build solidarity. And WBAI is key to this. You know, radio is an incredible medium. WBAI has this incredible potential. And, you know, I tell people, get out of your comfort zone. The amazing thing about New York City is you can get out. You don't need to go to Indiana. You can get out of your comfort zone by talking to the person next to you on the subway. You can get out of your comfort zone by talking to the person who lives one door down from you in your apartment building, the person at the deli. But we need to get out of our comfort zones and talk to people and start to build those small linkages. That is the basis of solidarity, to figure out how to honestly communicate and find those points of unity that we can slowly build and build and build, where we can actually have a mass struggle. And you can't do that without community media. You know, you're not going to get that from the capitalist media, right? So this is why I think that WBAI has a more vital role to play than ever at this moment, you know, to put into action the community and the media part.
All right. Thank you. So do you have time to take some questions?
Sure.
Questions? Or comments?
It's two different unions. United Steelworkers, or there's two plants in Indianapolis. That's United Steelworkers. Then there's a third plant in northern Indiana, Huntington. That was International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers. And I've written a couple of reports for the Raw Story. You can find the articles there. So the Carrier plant in northern Indiana, in Huntington, it's going to shut down by June. And the unit there is the IBEW, Electrical Workers Unit, is 783 members. And I went to their hall to interview all these workers, and I met with one of the officials in the union, and I asked him, how many workers do you have in your local? And he's like, 783. I was like, no, that's the plant, right? He's like, no, that is our entire local. So when that plant shuts down, that local disappears, you know, and I've seen that story all across, you know, the Midwest. You know, it's not just about factory jobs disappearing. It's also about unions disappearing. You know, this is another vital community institution, you know, where you can bring people together. And, you know, one of the things that, you know, unions have a lot of potential, and unfortunately, often the very top leadership is not really using that potential. But one of the great things about unions is you bring people together who often have wildly disparate opinions. You know, everyone from atheists to devout Christians, everyone from socialists to often people who are on the right wing. But they are something that potentially can act in the interest of the working class as a unified organization if it has, you know, a clear focus and ideological identity. And that also is the role of the left, you know, to give these organizations a clear ideological identity.
In talking to the people in the unions and other places who are losing their jobs,
yes,
has there been any kind of constructive analysis or dialogue regarding where the jobs are? Because there are a number of jobs that may not necessarily be manufacturing jobs that are here in the U.S. and they are not going anywhere. And I've been informed by my youngest son that the problem is that we are not trained to take those jobs. Where is that conversation? Because there's also jobs in the solar industry. People are talking about, let's dig up more coal, let's dig up more coal. People are still suffering from black lung disease who had coal. And now I understand there are studies that show that people who work in the coal mines in this day and age get black lung disease sooner.
Of course.
So now, why aren't we looking at where jobs are so that our young people and our people who are losing their jobs can get some of those jobs that really exist here. Because manufacturing jobs really, I don't see them coming back in great enough numbers to really hire a mass people.
That's a great question. This probably need to be the last question, but I'll try and there's a number of parts to this. First of all, folks may be familiar with the term precariat, right? You know, or gigatariat, or flexible contract labor. Just, you know, it means people who work on a specific contract part time. They don't have a permanent job. There's this notion that kind of what Krugman calls what people call the golden age of capitalism, the mid 40s to the mid 70s or even the mid 80s, that was the norm. It's not. The norm is actually the precarious economy. That's what the capitalist economy always used to be, a precarious economy. The industrial economy in the 19th century, from the first half of the 20th century, really, up until which it changed with World War II and the New Deal. Good-paying manufacturing jobs just did not happen. We have to remember that these steel workers, these auto worker jobs, the mine workers, all these various industrial jobs, longshore jobs, were really poorly paid, dangerous jobs, where people had great difficulty making it in terms of them and their families, or they had to have multiple people go into the workforce. So this was something that was fought for step by step by step, where a large part of capitalist profit was returned to workers in terms of wages and benefits, pensions, healthcare, and all that. And of course, hundreds of people died during the Great Depression and other labor struggles to win these advances. So similarly, there's a lot of work today in this economy. Jobs, when we talk about jobs, what we're usually talking about is full-time work with benefit. They're not necessarily that many jobs, but this is a matter of social struggle, right? So we should not just, there is no reason why Walmart jobs could not pay $15 an hour. The six heirs to Walmart are now worth close to $250 billion. Mm-hmm. Okay, extraordinary wealth. There's been plenty of studies showing that, in fact, shareholders would take like only a small hit if the Walmart workers all went up to $15 an hour within a year. That it would not have even that big. It would have a bit of an impact on the profit, but not necessarily that large. So this is a question of social struggle. How do you turn the precarious work into jobs? And there's the final part is there's always more work that's created. There's this British intellectual who does great work on labor, digital economy, and globalization. Her name is Ursula Hughes, HUWS, and she, this idea that we're at the end of jobs is absurd. She says, like, look at what hasn't been commodified yet. That will tell you where the next industries are. And she gives us an example that she was on a public bus in London, in England one day. This is over 10 years ago, and she sees a group of school children, teenagers, walking to school. And she says, if it had been a few years earlier, they would have been talking to each other. Every single one of them, and they were all walking as a group, were absorbed on their phones. And she's like, capitalism has commodified conversation, right? Mm-hmm. And you think about how many jobs are there in the global cell phone industry. It's extraordinary. Tens of millions of jobs, in the manufacturing and services and in sales and all the different apps and peripherals and equipment. It's a huge, massive industry. So capitalism will always create new sectors because it always needs to commodify something else. I mean, women's wombs, of course, have been commodified. There's one of the more absurd things, we live in a society so bereft of social context contact, there's now paid cuddlers, right? Usually with cuddlers, women who get paid to cuddle. There's no sex involved. They just lie down on, look it up.
That's a niche market.
I've met women who do this, you know.
The point is
that there's always going to be new forms of work created. Turning them into jobs is how we organize, and that of course is the first step, right? Of course we want good paying jobs where people can reproduce themselves in a healthy manner, but we want to go beyond capitalism, right? We just don't want to go back to like this notion that the best we can hope for is like a Keynesian capitalism that includes everyone. No, personally, I think we need to go to socialism, or full communism, right? Mm-hmm. So we need to go much beyond this. But it is a step-by-step strategic process that we need to engage in.
Now everything goes through social media. They're claiming this big women's march started with one email or one social.
Facebook post ended up
with millions of people around the world.
Yeah.
So how are we possibly at BAI going to stay relevant? What do we have to do?
You have to use those mediums. I mean, I think like. There's no reason BAI reporters can't. I've been using live streaming a lot, right? You can, and the great thing about, there was a lot of live streaming with Occupy Wall Street, but what it was just kind of raw footage. You need to do more value-added thing, right? There's no reason now where you have like high-quality cell phones, and you can for $100 get a really good shotgun mic. You can go into a community, you get a selfie stick, and you can then transmit that feed to WBAI, where you're actually like interviewing people. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, then you can also be live streaming it. So you're able to create multiple platforms. I mean, I think one an important thing is, to get these tools into people's hands and also the training, right? It's, one is, the tools are not that expensive, right? If you don't have any money, of course, a bag of chips is expensive, right? But we should be working to get these tools into people's hands, then get them the basic training. How do you use it? How do you frame the camera? How do you get a good audio feed? But then I think, and then the two other aspects is like, how do you operate as a journalist? And I will say it took me years to learn this. The key to a lot of good journalism is neutral questions, simple, neutral questions, where your goal is not, you're not there to argue with the person, right? You are there to bring out their story, their words. And what I liken it to is like, look, obviously we live in a society that is, very racist, very sexist, all sorts of oppressions. And I think often what happens, I see on the left, is a lot of moralizing and hectoring, where we shout at and shame people. And just like you remove a poison by drawing it out. If you push that poison in, it makes the body sicker, right? We need to draw that poison out, right? And so that's, I think, the value of getting the neutral questions. We want to really get at what people think, right? Because people are complicated. You can be talking to people who they can have left-wing ideas, and then they have also, like, often a lot of bigoted ideas, right? And I see this all the time. It's very few people who actually have a very sharp, clear analysis. We live in a very depoliticized society. So how do we encourage, these more liberatory ideas, but then we need to draw out, ideas that they hold that may be offensive or oppressive, and then, slowly work to rid the body of these ideas. And I think, it's going into community again. And the final part then is, again, that ideological sharpness, right? That we know when someone says something offensive, you don't agree with them. I think you don't condemn them, but you should. This is what I see, like a mistake some reporters make on the left, right? They'll think like, oh, it's the people. We have to validate their opinions no matter how offensive. No, bullshit. But you know, we have to do a better job learning how to talk to people and bring their opinions out and build points of unity that we can then struggle over the hard questions, over the question, you know, these issues of oppression that lurk out there, you know. But if we force it back in, I think that that's a problem, you know, because it lurks there. And I think that's, you know, there was this kind of attitude, and you know, we very much see this. I'll, you know, one just to wrap up, when I was interviewing all these workers who are being fired, who voted for Trump, who still support Trump, mm-hmm. right? We shouldn't find this surprising, right? How many liberals, you know, voted for Mr. Anti-War candidate Barack Obama, mm-hmm. who then goes on to last year, who's bombing 7 countries at the same, you know, in the same year, and they never. So why should we expect Trump voters to be any different? But the candidate they really liked was Bernie Sanders, and that was interesting, you know, because they got, you know, he was the one who was really speaking much more to him. But they are so desperate. You know, when you're drowning, you're going to grab onto a life preserver, no matter who's throwing it to you. Mm-hmm. You know, and the attitude of the Democrats is screw the entire working class, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's not just the white. You know, we have to like also challenge this narrative, like that this is a Democratic neoliberal narrative. They want to equate white with working class. No, that's absurd. You know, mm-hmm. the working class is white, brown, and black. You know, it is all racial and ethnic groups. But, you know, I think they really got it, that it was Bernie Sanders who was offering them real hope, whereas the Democrats were just like, no, you know, it's just like, we want nothing to do with the working class. We're going to basically this project of neoliberal capitalism and like social inclusion. You know, that was, you know, there's a good piece published a month or so ago by Nancy Fraser called Progressive Neoliberalism, about what the ideology of Hillary Clinton that I think really gets this anti-working class ideology. So, but we need the tools, we need the training for the technology, the journalism training, and then the ideological both sharpness and broadness, you know, and that is how I think we build community media that really serves the people.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, I have to run out of meetings.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Brilliant as always. Thank you.